Hello, ham radio operators across the entire world. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and this is Ham Radio Now, episode 15. Do that fly-through thing and settle down. This is going to be on grounding for lightning protection, something I think a lot of you will be pretty interested in. But we're not going to do that right away. We can never get to the program content right away. We always have to goof around a little bit first. And the first thing we have to goof around with is Arvin the Pig. Yes. Time to ask you to send in a little bit of money. Well, I can show you how to do that. And I'll tell you how I can show you how to do that in a minute. But first, we'll just show you how to do that. You go to the hamradionow.tv webpage, and you look right up here, and you see Arvin the Pig, and you click on him. And it takes you to our contribution page. And you can figure out how much you want to send. We have some suggestions. Look at the bottom of the page. Get down there and don't forget to play that, because that's going to be fun. Then you figure out what kind of a contribution you want to make. Somebody sent in $50 today. You can type in what you watched. Like Ham Radio Now, episode 15. And then you click on the pig, and it takes you to the PayPal page. And even though it's PayPal, you don't have to pay with PayPal. You can pay with a regular credit card. So if you have a PayPal account, and that's the way you want to do it, that's fine. But if you have just a credit card, you can do it with a credit card. PayPal, especially if you have a PayPal account, PayPal is going to try to talk you into using it, but stick to your guns and stick with a credit card and things will be fine. Let's see, what's next? Popular Communications Magazine ran a little thing about us. This is the August issue of Popular Communications Magazine. And they ran a little thing in the corner about Ham Radio Now. It was from the FCC, from Dayton, from the Dayton series and the FCC forum. They didn't use our hamradionow.tv URL. They used something they made up themselves for a direct link to YouTube. Hopefully, people who watch it will find their way to hamradionow.tv. And say, yes, I think it's time to send these guys some money. I'm harping on the money pretty hard tonight. Next, where have we been? Been a while since episode 14. Well, it's kind of a complicated answer, and I'm not going to go into all of it tonight. There's a bunch of things that have been keeping me off the air. Some of it is lots of freelance work, which is good. Some of it is I'm lazy. And sometimes it gets a little bit hard to get motivated. There's been plenty of stuff to do, but I just haven't put in the effort on the past month. Let's call it summer vacation. That's it, summer vacation. But we're back. And what else? I'll talk more about what we were doing in the next episode or the one after that, when I got a chance to banter with Jeff a little bit about it. Now, Jeff's not on the episode tonight. Speaking of Jeff, though, Jeff and I are both going to be going to the Huntsville Ham Fest in a couple of weeks. So if you're seeing this before Huntsville and you're going to go, look for us. We're going to have a booth. We'll be doing as many interviews as we can squeeze in, running around with the cameras. Not going to be selling anything. Won't even bring the pile of DVDs. We're just going to be there to do interviews and to talk to you. I'm thinking maybe I'll set things up so that if you come by and have something you'd like to talk about as part of a podcast for 5 or 10 minutes, we'll talk to you. So think about what you might want to talk about, broadcast to the world, and look for us at the Ham Radio Now booth at the Huntsville Ham Fest. Next. Wirecast. This is Wirecast, what I'm recording you on. That's why you're not seeing a great background right now. I'm just sitting over at the computer, the editing desk, what I call the Skype corner. I did set up a couple of handy talkies. Yeah, one there and one over there, sitting there next to the roaming gnome, to give you a sense of ham radio. But you know, this is not a good set. I just kind of threw this together. But I'm trying a program called Wirecast, which is going to let me do better Skype interviews and faster and easier interviews in general, because I'm able to switch live cameras and theoretically do all kinds of neat things. I don't know how to drive this. I've been playing with it for the past couple of weeks, but I don't really know it very well. The only thing I've got it set up to be able to do right now is to switch back and forth between a web page and the live camera. All right, so is it time? Well, it's almost time. Last time on episode 14, we left you with a cliffhanger. We were talking about two things in episode 14, the go-to station that we had set up, and basically how to set up a simple ham radio station. And we also showed you an antenna launching contest that was part of the field day from the field day site that Jeff and I were at for our local club, the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. Kind of a unique thing. And lots of people have been watching it. It's been very popular. But we left you with a cliffhanger. We couldn't tell you how the contest ended because the end required a video replay. One of the shots through, if you watched episode 14, one of the shots from one of the potato gun launchers in the accuracy part of the competition going through the hula hoop that was the target for the accuracy segment. One of the shots was hard to tell. Couldn't tell it live and in person. It went click, and it sort of hit the edge of the hula hoop, and nobody could tell whether it went through or whether it didn't. And Bob Starkenberg, W4TTX, who set things up, maybe made a little mistake. He thought, well, I'm going to cut a slot in the bottom of the hula hoop so that the line can drop through and you don't have to pull the weight back through the hula hoop. Well, that was good. But it also meant that if someone's shot just barely made it through, you couldn't tell if it made it through because the line was still there, because the line dropped out and you couldn't tell anymore. Well, we were recording, fortunately, and we could do a replay, but it wasn't an instant replay. We couldn't do it out in the field, so everybody had to wait. They took another shot. Cliff W4FT, who's one of my assistants here on Ham Radio Now, made a shot in the fourth round. And he got through. But there were only supposed to be three rounds. The fourth round was going to be for the event of a tie. And so since they couldn't tell if on the third round, Jack N6UYB made his shot go through, we had to do a fourth round. So then we came back and did the instant replay. And this is where we left you. We froze the action because that shot went to the replay booth for review, and the referee's decision won't be revealed until the August Radio Club meeting when Field Day Awards are presented. So sorry, but we have to leave you all in the dark until August.
So it's all or nothing, huh?
And again, we couldn't show you the replay on the episode because they wanted to hold the information off for the August RARS Club meeting and make the big announcement there. So this is what it looked like when Jack's shot was finally reviewed on instant replay. All right, let's do that replay of Jack's third shot. And it's still a little hard to tell, but careful analysis reveals that Jack's third shot did go through the hoop. So now, Bob Starkenberg, W4TTX, Field Day Chairman, and Contest Master, having plugged these results into your complex mathematical formula, have you determined a winner?
Yes, we have. Jack Foster, N6UYB. Now, just so Cliff doesn't carry a grudge for an entire year until next field day, we have an honorable mention trophy for you. For your valiant effort on your fourth shot at 15 feet, I believe it was.
Now, if you want to look at the whole thing from the club meeting, I put that up on YouTube as well. It's here on my auxiliary YouTube channel, KN4AQ2, which has got a bunch of other things on it that aren't part of ARVN or Ham Radio Now. And the very first thing on the site right now, the RARS Field Day Awards, August 2012, has that video. So you can go there and play it if you want to see the whole thing. And while you're there, check out some other stuff. This is an interesting one here, this Introduction to Amateur Radio. It's long before ARVN, long before Ham Radio Now, something that Jeff and I did back in 1999 as part of a ham radio class that we were teaching. Now, an introduction to ham radio is a daunting enterprise. Ham radio is big. And just about everybody that I've seen try to do something like that has, I'm going to say failed. At least sometimes they just point the fire hose at you and throw you way too much all at one time. Sometimes they miss things. They get bogged down in details of some of the arcane stuff like ATV or satellites, things that hams get into eventually but don't do when they first get started. So in our attempt, we tried to keep it simple. We showed some VHF FM operating, some HF voice, some HF Morse code. And it's been popular. I've only had it up on YouTube for a little while. It's got several thousand views and a lot of good comments. So you might enjoy watching that. But that's not what this program is all about. Is it time yet? Yes, it's time for the main event, grounding for lightning protection. I was at the RARS meeting, and mostly I was at the August RARS meeting to record the awards presentation and to be able to finish off the episode 14 on the contest. But I found out that the program for that meeting was going to be Tom Lewis, N4TL, and grounding for lightning protection. Hang on. Okay, we're back. Forgot to shut my phone off, and which is a good thing because that was a call from my wife, the lovely Cindy, KD4ACW. She's down in Charlotte helping her folks move. So she's heading for bed. It's pretty late, finally getting all this stuff sort of working. So I'm recording this late into the night. All right, so where were we? Tom Lewis, N4TL, at the RARS meeting, going to do a program on grounding and lightning protection, something I'd really like to have here on Ham Radio Now. So just kept the cameras rolling, and I got his permission, and we've got this program coming up in just a second. I noticed that George Thomas, W5JDX, has been talking about grounding and lightning protection on Ham Nation. And I also noticed that he got criticized for soldering. What can he do? He's the smoke and solder guy. For soldering his ground connection at the ground rod, something that I guess you're not supposed to be able to do. So watch that part of this program, and you'll see what Tom Lewis's suggestion is for how to connect to your ground rod. And no soldering is involved. Smoke, however, is involved. So where are we now? Oh, a little bit about Tom. Well, tell you what, I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to let RARS Vice President and Program Manager CJ Orr, NC4CJ, give you a little rundown on Tom's credentials.
He was first licensed when he was in high school in 1965. He's a young man, just like many of us. His call sign was WN2UIJ. He upgraded to his general license in 1967, and the call sign became WA2CQW. He received a master's degree in electrical engineering from the State University of New York in Buffalo in 1973, and he became an amateur extra in 1976. Tom and his wife and three daughters moved to South Florida in 1976, and that was a very eventful year for you. He received the call N4TL in 1977. He started chasing DX in 1980 and made DX CC in 1981. It took about 10 years to make the honor roll. He now has DX CC on 9 bands, 80 to 6 meters. Tom worked the last country he needed in 2007 which was BS7H, Scarborough Reef, and currently has 350 countries confirmed. He is a life member of ARRL, the Quarter Century Wireless Association, and the Antique Wireless Association. He currently works for IBM. So tonight he's going to give us a presentation, and the title of that is All You Want to Know About Ham Station Grounding for Lightning Protection.
All right, thank you, CJ. Now, one thing that's important to note, and Tom is going to mention this, and I'm going to mention it again, and I might even put up a little title here and there, is that Tom is not an expert in grounding. He is an electrical engineer. He got a master's in electrical engineering. He is not an expert in lightning protection, not an expert in grounding. These are just things he was interested in and has some experience in as a ham. And I certainly am not an expert in any of these. So we're presenting these as useful information for you, but with no guarantee that following these procedures is going to keep you safe. Now, this is interesting. I have often said that lightning will go where it wants, and it pretty much doesn't matter what you do in terms of lightning protection. If you get a direct strike and lightning wants to go and burn everything up in your shack, it's going to. Well, Tom's going to say something different. He's going to say that with proper procedures, and some of these proper procedures are the ones that are followed by broadcast stations and two-way installations, and maybe by hams not so much. With proper procedures, you can be very well protected. And of course, it's true, broadcast stations get hit by lightning. Their tall towers get hit by lightning all the time, and they don't get knocked off the air. Cell towers, two-way systems, with really serious lightning protection, get hit by lightning often, and the stuff in the radio room doesn't get blown up. Sometimes the antennas do, sometimes not. But lightning protection does work. But we can't guarantee on this program that following any of these procedures will keep you safe, keep you from getting hurt, keep your equipment from being damaged. That's not our job. In fact, there was a time when I was going to shoot a seminar on grounding and lightning protection for ARVN. And I talked to the guy that was giving the seminar, and he said no. He was sorry, but he felt comfortable enough giving a talk live before a bunch of hams, but not having it out there as a recorded program because he just felt he didn't want the liability. So that's the point. We are accepting no liability for you being safe as a result of watching and following these procedures. You should learn more about it yourself, but you put an antenna up, you do the lightning protection, but you still assume your own risk for what might happen once you've done that. All right, so I think it is finally time to, one more thing. Yeah, it's not finally time, one more thing. Tom is going to have a list of references that he will refer to several times throughout the program. It's a handout that he passed out at the meeting. And I will put it on the hamradionow.tv page on episode 15 when I get that up there. And it's something you're going to be able to download as a PDF. So every time he refers to something as a reference to this list of references, you'll get it as a PDF download at hamradionow.tv. Now, if you've arrived at this program directly from YouTube or somebody else's link someplace, and you haven't been to or haven't ever been to hamradionow.tv, well, that's where you want to go. Hamradionow.tv. Episode 15 isn't up yet on the website, but it will be soon. So that's where you want to go to get this list of references. All right. I think we're finally ready. Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Lewis, N4TL, and grounding for lightning protection from the August meeting of the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society.
Okay, so I gave this presentation to the Quarter Century Wireless Association back in June, and they asked me to give the presentation again tonight. So it's essentially the same. I have updated a few slides, and I've added some pictures in the front of some lightning damage. So I don't have a clicker here to go to the next slide. So can you go to the next slide? So I'm not an expert on the subject. I'm not an electrician. I'm not a professional engineer. But I have a master's degree in electrical engineering, and I've had my share of lightning damage. So I don't think that helped, I suppose. Next slide. So these first few slides are pictures of some damage. Jason heard I was giving this presentation, so he sent me some pictures. And this is from AA4XX damage that was done on his ham radio station. He has a 70-foot tower in a building out back. And a fire was started. Fortunately, it went out. Next slide. So this shows the feeder line. Looks like a dipole antenna with some ladder line and what's left of it. Next slide. And this is on the desk. Two books caught on fire and some other stuff. The books burned up completely. And the next slide. This shows some burned spots on the back wall where there's insulation. And it's fiberglass with the paper got burned. Next slide. And some stuff fell on this chair and caught it on fire. So I think he's really lucky that the fire went out on its own. Okay, next one shows some damage to a tree. This is behind my daughter's house, and this was a rather energetic strike because you can see the tree has got bark ripped off of it on both the front and the back. And on the front is quite a bit missing. It's a wide spot. And then down on the ground, it actually blew the dirt away from some of the roots. And this, my daughter lives across the road from me and up a few houses. And unfortunately, it also hit the house when it hit that tree. When lightning hit the tree, it also hit the house about right here on the side. Next slide. And the fire department report said the lightning entered the house about here, which is the over the stove, the range hood. So the fire started behind the stove, behind the hood that's above it. So my neighbor seen the smoke when he was driving home, he called 911, drove in my driveway and said, your daughter's house is on fire. And my daughter was at my house, so the three of us went running over there, and I grabbed the fire hose and I stood right about here, putting water on the stove and on the ceiling. The fire was dancing across the ceiling, and by putting water on it, that dancing slowed down and the fire on the stove went down a little bit too, but there's no way that the water hose was going to put that fire out. So the fire department came, and the next slide, and they put the fire out, and this is what was left in the kitchen. And I was a little surprised that the fire department pulled everything out of that kitchen that they could lift and threw it out the window, pulled down all the drywall. And I think what they were doing is they're looking for fire in the 2x4s. And right up in here, that 2x4 is burned. So they said that was the starting point of the fire, right up in there. And the whole kitchen was totally destroyed. Now the smoke damage to the rest of the house is as bad as that refrigerator. Everything in the house was black like that. And you can see the inside of the dishwasher melted. So I don't know what you can do about something like this. Next slide. This is the back of the house today. It's been rebuilt. Next slide. And that's the kitchen. Much different. And the house was, they had only lived in that house 6 months when it caught on fire, and it had wallpaper everywhere. So they asked me if I'd come help take down the wallpaper, so that's one thing I didn't have to do. So next slide. So I don't know, what do you do to protect for something like this? Because the lightning came in the side of the house. The fire department report stated that, and that's where the fire started. So I think the main thing you got to do for something like this is to have good working smoke detectors. So if you're in the house, you're going to know there's a fire, and have good replacement value of fire insurance. Next slide. Okay, this is the main part of the presentation. This shows my tower behind my garage. My wife and I moved here in 95 in the family, and I put up this crank-up tilt-over tower behind the house, behind the garage. And there's two antennas at the top. They're both Quickcraft beam antennas, and there's a inverted V for 40 and 80. At the base of the tower, I put in two ground rods, and then there's a plastic pipe back to the house. Next slide. And it connects to this box. So this wire goes to the tower. This one goes to a 60 meter inverted V, and this goes to a 160 meter inverted L. This one's not used, and that goes to the radio station, and the control wire goes to the radio station. So the relays in this box are set up so that the All antennas are grounded when I turn off 12 volts in the radio station. So I had the 12 volts turned off, antennas disconnected, that control wire disconnected, and lightning hit the tower one time. And next time I went to use the station, it didn't work quite right. The high SWR was high on two of those relay positions, but I found by just cranking the relay back and forth, the control box, it cleared the problem and continued to work. So I thought the antenna grounding system was halfway decent. But then lightning hit it again. And lightning does hit the same place more than once. But this time must have been more energetic. Next slide. I had lightning damage this time. It jumped from my disconnected wire to other parts of the station, and there was a burn mark across the carpet. So it damaged my ICOM 756 Pro, the 12-volt power supply, and a few other things. And for some crazy reason, the TV cable went afire on the far side of the house. So I was wondering, what's wrong? Why didn't it protect my station? So next slide. So I looked up how much voltage does it take to put a 4-inch burn mark in the carpet. And it all depends on temperature, pressure, shape of the structure. If it's a smooth cylindrical structure, it takes more voltage than a pointed structure. But I found one source gave 4 to 30 kilovolts per centimeter, and I converted that to 4 inches. So it was 40,000 volts to 300,000 volts, somewhere in that range. So I was puzzled. Why did I have damage when I had three ground rods, everything connected, the wires disconnected? So I had read the National Fire Protection Manual on how to install lightning rods. So I was at Dayton, and I bought the book from Polyphaser that was written by Ken Rand, and read through it and found out what was missing. So next slide. So I had two ground rods at the tower, but they were too close together. I didn't have any surge protection at the base of the tower. All my site's grounds were not connected together, and I wasn't using a single point ground at the radio room. When I read through the book, I realized I needed to have a more complete solution, not just a few ground rods and disconnecting wires. So next slide. So I talked to Polyphaser by email, and they said I had permission to use their book, anything in the book that I wanted. So some of my slides are copies of pictures out of this book. Next slide. Oh, there is a handout. I don't know if that got distributed. It talks about all my sources and where I got my information from. So these sources are listed on that piece of paper. So the ARRL website has a very good presentation, three-point part article on single-point grounds for the ham radio station. Very good reading. And then there's the National Fire Protection publication. This is very good for putting lightning rods on your house. Okay, when I was doing research for this presentation, I found this paper written by another ham. He gave a presentation to a bunch of amateur radio operators similar to what I'm doing tonight. He's W5BWC, and he gave me permission to use anything I wanted out of his presentation, and it was very nice of him. It is a little bit more complete than mine, so if you want to read something, that's good to check. Then when I was doing other research, I found this presentation. It was actually only a three-page thing by the professor of electrical engineering in New Mexico. And I'll talk a little bit more about him in a couple minutes. Next slide. And there's a couple more sources I used. Next slide. So the topics tonight are, what's the typical lightning strike? What kind of voltages are developed? What you should do for grounding? What is a single point ground and why its advantages? Recommendations and a few myths. Next slide. So lightning characteristics, it's 33 million average lightning strikes in the United States. And there's over 300,000 yearly damage for insurance claims. Now, after my daughter's house was hit by lightning, I called up the insurance company and asked them about it. And I said, if I put lightning rods in my house, can I get a little discount on my insurance? And they said, no. So I was really kind of surprised about that, because I know lightning rods do work when they're installed correctly. So there's lightning strikes continuously. There's websites you can go to and see where the lightning strikes are happening at the current time. And the average current is somewhere between 18,000 and 25,000 amps, depending on what source, what book you're looking at. Next slide. So this shows a cloud with positive and negative charges building up in the cloud. And it can be positive or negative. So you can have ground to cloud lightning, or cloud to ground, or cloud to cloud. Next slide. So a typical strike is about 2 microseconds rise time to 90% of its peak, and it decays to about 50% in 10 to 45 microseconds. And this, the place I was reading about it here, it said 18,000, and the other place said 25,000 amps, but still a lot of current. 1% of the strikes are up to 140,000 amps, and they recorded one at 400,000 amps. Next slide. So this shows the rise time and fall time of a lightning strike. This is the current waveform. The voltage waveform is a little bit different, but you can see it's a high frequency event. It goes up rapidly and decays rapidly. Next slide. And there's usually 3 or 4 strikes, very close in time. If you see a strike and hear the thunder, it'll look like one, but there's actually 3 in there, sometimes 2, sometimes more, very rapidly discharging of the clouds. Next slide. This shows that if you have a tall tower, you think it may be protecting you if you're standing not too far from it, but the protection only goes out to 150 feet. The National Protection Guidelines here shows a rolling spear of 300 feet diameter, and if you roll that across something, and if it can touch any part of the structure, lightning can hit it. And the shaded area, well, I guess it's not really shaded, but it's not 100% protection in this area either. So you can still get strikes here, but it's less likely than in the outside area. Next slide. So this shows lightning striking a bridge, and you can see it's hitting the top of the bridge as well as the lower points. And if you want to see some very good pictures of lightning, you go to the ARRL bulletin. It's the contest bulletin that just came out April 1st, a few days ago. And there's a link in that bulletin to high-speed videos, 7,000 frames a second of lightning hitting various things. So at 7,000 frames a second, you can see the lightning gradually coming down in fingers. And then when it hits, you get a large surge through that point. So it's very interesting videos to look at. Next slide. So in reading the polyphaser book, they pointed out that it takes millions of volts to go from a cloud to the tree or a house or whatever. But once it hits your tower or your dipole or whatever, Ohm's law can be used to calculate the voltages by knowing the resistance and inductance of whatever it's hitting, like a tower has a certain amount of resistance and inductance. Next slide. So the polyphaser book goes through calculations to figure out what those impedances are. Next slide. So for a ham tower, you're probably going to have a few ground rods at the base, but not going to have hundreds like a radio station. So reading the polyphaser book, it kind of sounded like they were saying there are 0 volts at your ground connection, but that's not true for a ham station. When the tower gets hit, there's inductance, resistance of your tower and your ground system. So the 0 volt point is going to be below ground. Next slide. So this shows a tower, earth surface, and the ground rod. And this is a little drawing I did on the computer, so you can tell I'm not too good at this type of thing. Next slide. So when the lightning strikes, there's going to be a lot of current going through that piece of metal or that wire, depending on what you got. So the maximum voltage is going to be right at the top of the tower, goes down to your ground system, but it's not going to be 0 at the ground wire. It's going to be 0 below ground. Next slide. So we add a Radio Shack. Next slide. And a wire into it. So this is kind of what I had at first on my tower. I had the wire going from the very top of the antenna into the Radio Shack. So I was delivering the maximum voltage from the top of my tower down to my little relay box that was a single ground rod. So it didn't handle the current sufficiently to stop damage in my radio station. Next slide. So polyphaser points out that if you ground the shield and put a surge protector at the place that leaves the tower and heads to the radio room, you can lower the voltage on the coax. So they showed a 1,000-foot tower
with a radio room off to the side or a transmitter site, and it came across the cable tray. But for communication sites, there's lots of ground, so that might work for them. But for the ham radio operator, next slide, it should be really connected at the bottom of the tower. So make the connection at the bottom, put a surge protector there, next slide, and add additional ground rods. You want multiple ground rods so that resistance is in parallel, reduces the inductance and resistance, and lowers the voltage. Next slide. So the earth ground is not perfect, and when you drive a ground rod into the ground, it's going to contact the earth with a certain amount of pressure, and it's not going to be uniform. It's not going to be a perfect contact. And the book did point out to not dig a hole, put the ground rod in, and fill it in again, because then the compacting of the dirt won't be very good. So there's different ground conductivities. Wet marshland or over by the ocean is going to be better. Dry desert is going to be worse, and then the high Rocky Mountains is going to be kind of poor. So North Carolina is in there in the middle someplace. Next slide. Ground rod depth makes a big difference too. Now, when you first buy your house, it's been inspected and there's a ground rod by your electrical panel, and that's usually about 2 feet long. It doesn't do very much at 2 feet long. The resistance is going to be too high to the ground. So at my house, I added another ground rod not too far from the electrical panel, and a real one, a 6-foot ground rod, and ran a wire to the box and called up the power company and asked them to connect it. So when the guy came out, he said, "Why are you doing this? You've already got a ground rod." So I didn't bother to explain it to him, just asked him to hook it up. So this shows resistance of a ground rod. If it's a 10-ohm ground rod with 18,000 amps coming down, you're going to have 180,000 volts at the top of that ground rod. That's kind of high. So parallel, putting them in parallel and connecting them all together is much better. So next slide. So when the lightning hits, current flows from your ground rod out to the ground, and as it leaves the ground rod, the density is very high, and as it spreads out, the density reduces. Next slide. So if you have two ground rods close together, that current's going to overlap. That's what I had on my tower in the beginning. I had two ground rods rather close, so they was really only acting as one ground rod. Next slide. So the rule of thumb is if you have an 8-foot ground rod, you should have the rods 16 feet separated. If they're 10-foot ground rods, they should be 20 feet apart. Next slide. So at the base of the tower, it's best to have surge protectors, rotator surge protector, more than one ground rod, at least three, I would say. The polyphaser book tells about what kind of wire to connect your ground rods with, and then they say it depends on your soil conductivity. Number 10 wire for good, 1.5-inch strap for poor. But I think in this area of North Carolina, number 2 wire is appropriate to use. Next slide. And if you're not familiar with wire sizing, number 2 wire is about 1/4-inch diameter. And as the number goes up, the wire gets smaller. A 00 wire is 0.36 diameter. And that's what I'm using from my tower to the first ground rod. I'm using 00, but that's only about 2 feet long. Next slide. And you can buy surge protectors from Polyphaser and other companies. They're little things that look like this. These are non-conducting for DC. So at the top of my tower, I have a control, an antenna, Amatron antenna relay, and that uses voltage on the center conductor to control it. So I had to use a different brand to on my installation. Next slide. And this shows a cable rotator surge protector. It can be used for other DC voltages as well. Next slide. So at the base of my tower, I added this metal box. And next slide. Inside the box, I have a rotator surge protector and an alpha delta surge protector. And the alpha delta does pass the DC and AC current through the center conductor. And next slide. When I took the pictures of my tower back in June, I noticed there was a little rust here and there. So I got out the paint and touched up the rust spots. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with this kind of paint. It's a cold galvanizing compound. Pretty good for using on a galvanized tower. It slows the rust down. It's a little expensive, though. I paid $115 for that gallon of paint, and it's very heavy. Next slide. So the National Fire Protection Code says that when you put a ground wire in, a grounding wire, don't bend it any sharper than 8 inches, because it adds inductance. If you have a sharp bend, you've got higher inductance right at that corner. And it says don't bend it more than 90 degrees. If you go more than 90, make it smaller than 90, the inductance may be high enough where you get arcing across from the ground wire to the ground wire. And if that goes around a piece of wood, you may get a fire. Next slide. So they also show how to connect the ground rods from the house to a ground rod that's buried using cable clamps. I went on to the internet and did a search for parts for ground rods. And there's a few companies out there selling all the equipment you need to put on your own home ground rods. And they sell these clamps that are either crimp on or bolt on, and all the equipment you need to do it. So my father, back in 1950s, had lightning rods put on the farmhouse in the barn. And when they installed those lightning rods, this wire, this ground rod was very close to the house over here, and this connection was above ground. And it was crimped onto the wire, and then you can see if there's any corrosion or anything. Now, if it's below ground, you may have a trouble with corrosion, but the NFPA guide does show bolted connections like this. Next slide. So I found that there are large split bolts that are large enough to go over a half-inch ground rod. It doesn't really show up in this picture, but it's a split bolt like that, and it's a big one. Next slide. And then there's other pieces of hardware you can buy for making connections for grounds. You can buy these type of clamps that are big enough for a half-inch ground rod, and these are split bolts. I find these split bolts are handy for when a wire antenna breaks. Then the big, this is a number two wire and a great big lug. And then these are for a push-up mask. If you have a TV type mask with a 2 meter antenna on it, a vertical, you can put this on the base and run a ground wire to it. But now one of those clamps up there, I would not use it. I used one in the past and I had trouble with it. So can you tell there's one that's a little bit different? See, this one here, it's got, instead of brass or bronze screws, it's got steel. And that steel is going to rust after a while. So that's the trouble I had with one of mine. This got so rusty, I couldn't turn them anymore. So if you see these at the Hamfest, buy the ones that are all brass or all bronze. Don't buy the ones with steel screws. Next slide. At least that's my recommendation. So now if you have a connection that's underground, you can use a Cadwell one shot. It produces a permanent connection that won't loosen with time. Next slide. So Carl was kind enough to give me some pictures of his installation when they did his grounding work. So this shows the top of a ground rod right here. Next slide. And this is the Cadwell burning. So it welds everything together. It makes a permanent connection. So Carl had NC4 CD install it for him. Next slide. So then they used this equipment to measure the ground rod conductivity, 2.4 ohms. Now this machine, they had to run wires out some distance away from the house and the ground rods and measure the resistance of their ground conductivity. So 2.4 ohms is pretty good. And I believe he had three ground rods installed or connected together. Next slide. Okay, for the radio room, use a single point ground, make sure all cables are connected to it, and make sure it has a low impedance connection to ground. Next slide. Okay, so this shows a installation that does not have a single point ground. So you've got a ground rod here, and your coaxial cable has a surge protector. The coax comes into your radio station. Radio station, power supply, whatever, is plugged into the AC power off to your branch circuit, and then the power panel is grounded. And there's going to be other equipment here, rotator, and whatever else you got in your radio room. So if you disconnect wire right here like I did, the lightning comes in, charges this thing up, and there's a big difference in voltage from A to B. Disc ground rods, a few hundred thousand volts, you know, maybe 40,000, maybe 100,000, and this one's zero. So what's going to happen? You're going to have an arc somewhere from this ground to something here or this power plug. So for the high energy lightning strikes, you've got to do more than just disconnect the antennas and have a ground rod. Next slide. So now this square box right here represents a single point ground. Now that's going to be a metal plate, probably made out of copper, surge protectors on it, surge protectors for your AC power, surge protectors for a rotator cable or whatever else you got. So now when the lightning hits and this A point jumps up to some high voltage, all of this stuff goes up and down together. There's not a difference in voltage. There shouldn't be any arcing. And hopefully there won't be damage. But, okay, next slide. A single point ground is not complete though, unless you have a ground wire from A to B. Because if this goes up to some high voltage, it's protecting the radio room, but it's not going to protect other things on your AC branch circuit unless you've got this additional ground wire. When my house was hit, my tower was hit the second time, I wondered why in the world did the cable preamplifier get fried? It's way on the other side of the house. So what happened is it jumped my wires, got into the ground here, went through this thing, went over to the cable TV box, and out to the cable TV, and there's a ground rod for it. So it went through the house wiring and took out the cable TV amplifier. Next slide. So this shows a single point ground panel or a piece of copper that you can use. These are available from different places. It's a piece of flat copper mounted on a piece of wood. Next slide. And you can buy these type of things. If you've got your surge protectors at the base of the tower, you probably can use this for your single point ground and just run all your cables through it. Next slide. An AC power protector. I believe this is made by Polyphaser. This will be mounted on your single point ground. Next slide. Copper strap. I found KS7P has a metal shop, and he's selling products for grounding, and he sells this copper strap. The copper strap has a larger surface area than round wire, so it does a better job of grounding whatever you're going to ground because it has a lower inductance. A few years ago, I went to Channel 5 TV transmitter site, and they were using this stuff a step wider, all around the baseboard, all around the ceiling, and strips of it up and down to connect everything together. So they had quite a bit of that copper strap in the transmitter room. Next slide. Then this stuff, you can put between the pieces of copper so it doesn't oxidize on you. Next slide. So KF7P sells that material from the previous slide, and this is his own entrance panel. So you can see he's got the copper sheet, all of his surge protectors mounted, rotator cable surge protector, and at the bottom here is a copper strap. It's bolted right here, goes out of the slot in the bottom down to his ground system. So that gives a very good low impedance ground to our connection to his ground. If you notice over here, where all of his wires go through the wall, there's a braid right there and a piece of copper holding it. So he's got a wide braided connection inside going to his inside panel. Carl's single point ground. He's got surge protectors here, the telephone surge protector, AC power protectors, and copper strap. Next slide. So the copper strap goes behind his radio equipment. Next slide. All the way over. Next slide. So see, Carl did it right. He put the ground in first. How many people had put in their radios and say, oh, I got to put a ground in? And then it's kind of hard to get behind everything. Next slide. And with his radio equipment on the boxes. So it's so much better to do the ground first. And thanks, Carl, for the pictures. Next slide. So all sites, all grounds connected together. This includes your AC power panel, the cable TV ground, and your home plumbing. Anything else that's got a ground rod on it, connect it all together. Next slide. So use a single point ground with your surge protectors on it. Flat copper wire is better. I guess I covered that. Next slide. I used to work at IBM Boca Raton, Florida, and we were fortunate to have a radio room on the second story of a building. Downstairs was the IBM security office with all kinds of monitors and equipment, and we were right above them. We had four towers, and they were all installed by IBM. They wouldn't let us do that work. So all those towers were connected into the ground system of the building. There was lightning rods every so many feet across the flat roof, and the towers were bonded into the ground system of a lightning rod system. And right next to the one wall in the radio room, we had a hole cut, had a flat plate put in there with all the feeds through to it. So everything went through that panel, and it was bonded to the building's I-beams and ground system. So lightning hit one of our 2-meter antennas. It was a vertical with a piece of fiberglass between the top and bottom part, and it just blew that antenna apart. We found pieces all over the roof, but there was no damage to the radio station or IBM's equipment. So in that case, the lightning grounding system worked quite well, but that was a professional installation with lots of grounds and steel rods all connected together. Next slide. So one more comment about this. If you have all your grounds connected together and you get a strike, you are going to, hopefully all the current goes through here, but that's probably not going to happen. You're probably going to have some going through this branch circuit and to other parts of the house. So if it goes off to your TV and through it, you may have troubles with that. Next slide. So you can add a cable TV power surge protector. So this has surge protectors built in for your AC power, surge protectors for your cable, and surge protection for your telephone. So this is behind my TV. And one thing they don't point out when they sell these things is that it gives you a ground connection from this shield to this ground. So if your surge comes in on the power line, it doesn't have to go up through your TV set and back down the cable to go out to the cable ground. It's got a nice short path right here, and it'll help protect your equipment. So this is a good thing to have if you have cable TV and a TV set. Next slide. Okay, one of the presentations I read to you when I was doing my research talked about myths, and one of them covered electrostatic dissipation devices. Now, these are the devices that look like porcupines on top of a tower, all these little pointy things coming out. And the polyphaser book did a little mathematical study in the back about how fast can you dissipate charge versus how fast it's coming in. And they concluded it can't keep up. Also, they cited a Navy study. I think NASA and the Navy and some other parts of the government did some studies, actually put these things up and measured how many lightning strikes they were receiving. And they determined it didn't make any difference. The same number of lightning strikes hit, whether you had these or not. So they concluded they don't work. Next slide. So then I found William Ryson there, professor of electrical engineering in New Mexico. He does studies in this type of thing, and he must have seen an ad or something for these things. So he wrote a 3-page article about charge transfer systems do not work, do not reduce the number of lightning strikes. So it's 3 pages, a bunch of math in there, and he shows how the other people with their math were wrong, and he was calling it junk science. I had a friend in Fort Lauderdale, lived not too far from a real tall church, and he said he didn't have to do anything with lightning because it protected him. But that's obviously not the case. If you're more than 150 feet away, you don't have any protection. Next slide. And I think I pointed this out earlier. I did already mention the protected area is only 96% protected, so you can still get hits in that area. Next slide. Now, when my dad had the lightning rods put on his house and barn back in the 50s, a neighbor up the road said, "You're wasting your money. Those things will attract lightning and they don't work." But I know they work, because when I was in the house, thunderstorm, lightning like crazy, thunder and lightning at the same instant, and the barn got hit right in the center. And holy cow, it lit up the sky, but there was no damage. The system did what it was supposed to, and there was no damage. And then another time, I'm sitting in the kitchen, and the windowsill is a little wet, and the thunder and lightning happened at the same instant, like they're right above the house. Well, just before that noise, the hair on my arm stood up on edge. What's going on? And then bang, and then I could feel a little static on my arm. So I was thinking we might have got hit at that point too. And unfortunately, a neighbor down the road from where I lived did not have lightning rods on his barn. It got hit by lightning. The fire was not seen for quite a while, and the barn burned completely to the ground. His car and his tractor was in there. Fortunately, he had enough fire insurance to cover the loss. Next. So one of the government studies I found talks about, they actually went out to the field to see why people think lightning rods don't work. So they went to a number of places, and here's one barn they found that has a lightning rod on top, right here, but there was no wires. So, you know, what's it gonna do? If it gets hit, it's certainly not gonna work. Next slide. And another picture they had in the report showed there's lightning rod here, here, and here, and they're all interconnected, and there's a conductor comes down, around the roof, and down. So they pointed out there's a 180-degree bend around the roof here and here, and because of the inductance of the wire, it's probably going to go right through the roof and start a fire. So in that case, you've got down conductors, but it's not going to do its job. Next slide. So the National Fire Protection Agency, this red book, this is a newer copy of this, is available on the internet, it's on the reference sheet, shows the correct way to put lightning rods on a house. Now I put this on here because it shows water pipe connection, whole house surge protector, which is good, electrical ground is interconnected, and it shows the proper way to clamp the wires together. I also wanted to show that they say if you have to have the lightning rods across the roof to protect the roof, and this point could be hit too. And you need to have a down conductor for that lightning rod. So someone might say, well, why bother with this wire? And they say that if you don't have that wire, it might arc over across the roof and cause a fire if this upper rod is hit. So then someone might say, well, if you've got this wire, why do you need the down conductor? And the book says, if it hits this rod, it's not going to go up, over, and down. Hits this rod, it's going to keep going down. So you have to have that ground, that down conductor as well. On my dad's farmhouse, it's very similar to this. Well, a lot simpler, I should say. The ground wire came up, crossed the roof, and down the far side, and there was a chimney in the middle. But inside the house, they had the water pipes connected, they had the electrical ground connected, the water pump was on the far end of the house, bathroom over here and the kitchen over there. So I was a little surprised. They connected the ground to the plumbing, but they also ran a wire from here across the house to the other plumbing when it's already connected to the pump. So they were doing another ground-to-ground connection. And that's because the distance, if something gets hit, they don't want it arcing ground to ground because of inductance in the line. So, okay, next slide. So, yeah, I've heard, this is my neighbor, nothing will save you. But how many times have you heard people being injured in a commercial building where they had professional people come in and put in lightning rods, down conductors, ground system. A lot of commercial buildings get hit, but you don't hear about people getting hurt because it works. You do it right. And like I said, I seen lightning hit my dad's barn. Next slide. So the recommendations from most of the things I read, that was that one that talked about the charge dissipation devices actually said those things will stop lightning by 95%. I don't see how he can say that when it's been shown not to work correctly. But all the other ones have recommendations like this: a properly grounded tower or antenna support, good ground system, not a single ground rod, multiple ground rods connected together, all site grounds connected together, all conductors entering the amateur radio station grounded to a single point ground, surge protection on your AC line, and I didn't talk about a dwelling perimeter ring. I'll let you guys read about that in the references. Next slide. So there are a number of things I have not covered. Galvanic corrosion, inductively coupled lightning, the dwelling perimeter ground ring, and some other stuff. So take the time, if you're interested, and read at least the first three references. They're on the handout sheet that hopefully everybody's got a copy. Next slide. So any questions?
I have heard that flat mounting strap, like you mentioned, is good for connecting grounds together. I've also seen heavy gauge kind of woven wire with each of the wires in the weave being about 12 or 14 gauge, totaling about 3/4 inch diameter.
Yes.
And also just plain old flat tin copper braid, which is obviously more economical than the big bundles of copper. Have you experienced any, or run across any information as to which one of those works better, and what quantity of copper it takes to get the job done for interconnecting of the grounds?
Okay, his question is about braided copper wire versus flat copper stock to do the grounding. On my father's farm, the professionals used the braided copper wire from the ground rod up about 2 feet. It's big around as my thumb, more than a half an inch, and it was an open braid. It was not just wound like you see normal copper wire. It had kind of a weave to it, and it looked like, to me, they were leaving it a little bit open, maybe so it would stay dry. I don't know for sure. And then, when I went to the Channel 5 transmitting site, they used that copper strap, a lot of it. So my personal opinion would be the copper strap is probably better because they're using that at the TV station, and the braided stuff is probably okay for the lightning rods on your house. But I don't remember seeing any reference that said which one was better than the other, but they all did point out that the flat stock has a larger surface area. Lightning is a high-frequency event, and the current flows on the surface of the wire, so that larger surface area works quite well. I answer the question? Okay. Okay, well, thanks for your attention, and I hope you got something out of it.
Thank you, Tom. Good presentation. One more time. We're going to make the disclaimer of responsibility. If you follow these instructions to the letter and your equipment gets blown up by a lightning strike or you're injured, and I hope that never happens, we claim no liability, no responsibility. Following these instructions does not guarantee your safety, does not guarantee your equipment or your house or your antenna. It's a good idea to do lightning protection. It's a good idea to become educated on it. This has given you a good start. There's plenty more to learn. A 45-minute presentation does not, it more than scratches the surface, but it doesn't get you very deep in this. You could study this for weeks, probably for years, and still have things to learn. So thanks, Tom, and that's our presentation on grounding for lightning protection. Once again, don't forget, if you enjoy or get some value out of Ham Radio Now programs, stop by our website, arvn.tv. There it is. Click the pig. That is Arvin the pig. And I'll have a chance to make a contribution. Something doesn't look right here. It's Wirecast. I don't know how to drive Wirecast yet. So that's it. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 15, coming to a close. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, totally discombobulated. We'll see you next time. Over and out.